Hi, everybody. How are we doing tonight? Okay. I know some of you in the room. My name's Carrie Cranston. I'm the president here at the American Writers Museum. Next week, we have our monthly Get Lit. It is February, so it is about rejection and Valentine's Day. We will read author rejection letters and other types of rejection letters and shred them.
I could offer a few.
If you want to send a couple along, we will read them out loud at the open mic. If you enjoy our programming, you know, please think about becoming a member and participate in our programs here and online. And hello to our online audience. Now, all that being said, I'm going to do a brief introduction. Our esteemed guest, Ed Zwick, is a filmmaker and storyteller, a producer, director, and screenwriter. He's had a 40-year career using film and television to tell powerful stories about very real characters. He has worked with some of the greatest actors and writers and told stories, both historical and fictional, that hit on deep issues, from Glory to Legends of the Fall, and from Defiance to The Last Samurai and Blood Diamond. He has told amazing stories that move audiences on a giant scale. But he's also created film and television that is extremely modern and personal, from the shows 30-something and My So-Called Life and movies like About Last Night and Love and Other Drugs. We are honored tonight to talk to him about the elements of storytelling that may start with a screenplay but are shaped by the work of so many people before the audience sees an actual film. And of course, we want to talk about his new book that explores his 40-year career, Hits, Flops, and Other Illusions, My 40-something Years in Hollywood by Ed Zwick. And so we're excited about that. The best thing, though, about having a filmmaker write a book is that you get the best book trailer you've ever seen. So we're going to play that trailer for you guys and the folks online right now. Thank you very much for being here. Before we get the book, I would like to start talking about just writing in general, based on having read the book, and I know you guys haven't because it's not out yet, but we do have copies for sale tonight. And for those of you online, there's a link in the chat. But you know, it's so complex, the idea of writing for film, the idea of who's involved in the process, and how we get there. From, say, writing a novel or a short story that some of us are more used to seeing programs on. So I'd like to start with television, because that is sort of where you started after film school. Your focus was to be a director, but you started writing for the TV show Family. Mm-hmm. And in that instance, you're stepping into something that's already been created. There mm-hmm. are showrunners, there's preceding material. You're coming in, I think, in season 3. Can you tell me about what it means as a writer to try and write for something like that?
I did not do particularly well. It was thrilling to work professionally and to have an opportunity to actually have my words, or at least what began as my words, find their way to the screen. I think in that first year that I did it, I am convinced that the showrunner rewrote every word that I wrote, but with good reason. Mm-hmm. It was a remarkable opportunity to fail and to do things that showed me at least the way towards something else. But it also was the introduction of a form. You know, television is a form. It's like a scan, the sonnet form or the villanelle form. It's a scansion and a rhyme scheme. And so things are according to a certain set of expectations.
Yeah.
And at that time, television was really only expectations. Everyone was a fireman or a policeman or a, hospital worker, whatever it was. That's what television was. So what was new about this show was that a very real writer, a woman named J. Preston Allen, a great playwright who wrote The Prime of Miss Jean Brody, and she wrote the movie Prince of a City, was a real writer. And so she approached it differently. She just told a story of this family. And it was directed by Mark Rydell, a real movie maker, and produced by Mike Nichols. So these were some very fancy people. I'll add that I had exactly one word with Mike Nichols in an elevator over the course of the first year, in which I found myself alone with him, and he turned to me and said, "And you are?" That was my encounter with Mike Nichols. But you know, it was a great thing, even though I was constantly frustrated. And what I didn't know is I was frustrated probably for good reason, because I was being asked to be to some degree false. It was a depiction of family life that was somewhere in that liminal space between what the 1950s were and what the world was going to become in the 1970s. So they were trying with little baby steps to introduce more reality. But in fact, when I would presume to write about what I knew adolescence to be, say, with the kids or the parents fight, whatever it was, there was always this sense of real sort of top-down pressure to sort of keep it nice and keep it polite. Mm. And ironically, at that moment, I vowed, even to myself, that somewhere down the road, I would have the chance to give at least my impression of what family life really was.
And with My So-Called Life and 30-something, you were able
exactly.
to do that.
That's that found its way. And by the way, even before that, it was about last night, because you know, there was David's play, and already it was, you know, a step out into a very different vernacular and a very different sense of reality. So that's where that journey began.
Wow. And now you also got a chance to start directing on family.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you start to direct, how does that help you shape the story versus writing it?
Here again, badly. it was interesting. I mean, I'd gone to film school and I paid attention. I'd been very interested in the theater, but I didn't really know a lot about the vernacular of film. And when I had this opportunity, what I was taught to do was write in that same metronomic form of what direction was in television. And the best directors are the ones who got the crew home by 5 o'clock. And so I would look at the work, and I got to, it was a wonderful opportunity to be behind the camera and to try to talk to the actors, although they didn't talk to me very much because already the show had been going and they were very involved and set in their ways. But I would look at it afterwards and I was ashamed. I was quite disappointed. I didn't know how to do it differently, but I knew what I was doing wasn't what I wanted to do.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think it pertains to some journey, because there was no such thing as directing or writing to me. And the way I was trained is that it's all the same, that the writer is doing the actor's jobs and the director's jobs. And if he's not, then he's not a real writer. In other words, he's not creating words that need to, can be said, or scenes that make sense with all the things that scenes need. And if he's doesn't have a sense of mise-en-scène in it, then the director is being given something that doesn't have shape. So those writers or writer directors whom I always admired, they never made that distinction really. And if the words weren't right, they would make them right.
I think you quote someone at some point in the book where you mentioned the idea that you can make a bad movie from a good script, but you can't make a good movie from a bad script.
Yeah, and I was often the person having to make the bad movie from the bad script because I didn't know what I was doing. or other times when even down the road on the stage, I would look at it and look at something that this stupid writer had written. He just happened to be me and it didn't work. And it was my job to make it work.
And then, so then, you know, coming off of family, you got that amazing opportunity with About Last Night, which of course was not called that at the time.
Let me stop you there. Because, you know, I remember when my son was starting to do various things and the temptation is to look at a career from 30,000 feet
yeah.
and assume that it's some sort of trajectory. It's quite the opposite. There were some many lean years after that and struggle mm-hmm. before then found some real voice.
Right. There were some other shows and a TV there were, movie. Yeah, there were dolls.
Writing jobs and there were mm-hmm. Rewrite jobs, and none of them really quite found a true express. I was still searching. I don't think it really was until I was in my late 20s, maybe 29, 30, that a lot of things happened.
Yeah.
Personal things. My mother was killed in a car accident. I fell in love. I had a child. I was confronted with life in a way that I had never really been. And somehow that opened something. You know, a word might be chakra. It allowed things to flow in a way that they never had before. And I lost a lot of inhibition that I might have had that might have been holding me back.
Yeah.
So it really wasn't until then that things started to take off. Ironically, when they did, there was a real trajectory.
That's really interesting, you know, that idea of what it takes to get there, the failures in the beginning, the mm-hmm. struggle, and wanting to tell a story, but your own life having to change.
No, I bless the failures.
Yeah.
I do. I really think that only in the sort of humiliation and mortification of that do you ever learn anything, because success is essentially mystifying. It makes you anxious. You don't know why it happened, and mm-hmm. you don't examine things necessarily.
You know, in your book, you talk a lot about the idea of writing on your own or with your partner Marshall, mm-hmm. Or with other partners, you know, in the sense of maybe somebody who's written a screenplay mm-hmm. and you're working with them on it. You know, when it comes to writing, you know, what do you like or dislike about writing with a partner?
Well, I mean, if it's a real partnership, there's only things to like. Mm-hmm. I'll set aside Marshall just for a moment mm-hmm. because that's a very unique partnership that has lasted all this time. I'll start by saying the list of writers with whom I've been able to work is extraordinary. And whether that's people like John Logan, who's actually from here, or Tom Stoppard, or right. Bill Whitliff, I mean, great, great writers. There's always your idea. And then there's someone else's idea. And if you're really in a partnership, it's that third idea that emerges that becomes the one that is better than either you could have thought about. With Marshall, it's a little different, which is that we know each other so well that a willingness to admit those secret, unbidden thoughts that you're a little bit almost embarrassed to admit, like, oh, I've got this really, I mean, what if, nah, and you're heavy with this inhibition, and then you eke it out, and then the other person says, that's it, that's the thing. And that it brings to mind actually one of my very favorite essays by Emerson, which is the essay on self-reliance, mm-hmm. which says that the thing that you is most private to you when you express it is the thing that is recognized by everybody else. And that's the basis of my relationship with him, in addition to which he's nicer than I am and is a better writer. But when you're in the privilege of working with another writer, my role is a little different. My job is to try to identify what might be latent in their work and tease it out and try to make it manifest. And in that regard, I'd always had a dream that I was going to be, you know, William Shawn, you know, at the New Yorker, that I was going to be Max Perkins, you know, and that it was an opportunity to have a different role with a great artist. And that's the privilege of working with people that you don't know, or you're able to then.
Yeah. And then, you know, obviously in the storytelling process, the director has a lot of input, actors have an input, producers have an input. You know, you have often filled the role of being involved in the writing at the front end, or, you know, as the second person, then directing, or maybe you're helping with the writing because you're going to direct, and maybe you're producing. How does it impact you? And I know there's a section where you kind of talk about being a writer-director, but how does it impact the story when you're doing multiple roles? How does that, you know, what's the good side of that and what's the bad side of it?
Well, I mean, film being a procession of strong images finally beggars any words. And great actors will inevitably show you much rather than tell you. Mm-hmm. And similarly, so will the cinematographer. And so will my editor. You know, that you're working toward a set of iconic or storytelling images that often so far exceed what words might be. Mm-hmm. And I think the director is trying to move the film toward a moment or several moments in which that's understood, and you could watch a movie without words in some fundamental degree. Now, obviously, language is important to me, and I'm not talking about, you know, His Girl Friday, where the dialogue is like music, and obviously that's important. But there was a thought I was just about to say about that. It'll come to me.
Now, I'd kind of like to get into some of the specific films, mm-hmm. and again, we'll start off talking about the writing process, then we'll get to more about the book. You brought up about Last Night. You know, in that instance, you're not writing so right. much because it's Mamet.
Mm-hmm. And well, it's Mamet, and then it's Tim Kazurinsky and Denise right. DeClue. So it's three writers already. Yeah.
Yeah. So you are directing at this point. And so in that instance, can you talk a little bit about when you've got something that's perhaps so rock solid? Mm-hmm. On the screenplay side, mm-hmm. how then as director do you feel in that specific instance?
Well, first of all, it need be said that nothing is ever rock solid.
Yeah.
And it may look great on the mm-hmm. page, and then you put it on its feet and it's a problem. And then you work that out. I mean, I often think that what they often pay us for is figuring out on the day, mm-hmm. because we thought it was going to work and now it isn't. And the set isn't right, or the actors doesn't feel, the words don't feel right in their mouth, or there's a scene's been written where the food is delivered to the table and they're having a conversation, and then they're supposed to get up and leave three lines later, and there's no logic, you know. So there's always that. But there are certain people in this room who will know that directing was a thing that was in my head long mm-hmm. before. And it was about looking at a piece of work and just trying to figure out what the behaviors would be that would illuminate things, often even without the words.
Yeah.
And so that was about Last Night. The reason it was such a wonderful opportunity is not just because it was a local boy made good and come back, but it was going back to a moment in my life that wasn't so very long past, mm-hmm. about the difference between sex and love, about dealing with friendships and you know, things that are very familiar, and the currency was available to me. So it was like slipping into a warm bath. I wasn't reinventing film or reinventing behavior. I was actually imitating things that I knew.
Yeah. And so as you bring that up, you know, one of the things that happens in the book a lot is that we see your personal life as how it intersects with your professional life.
Yes.
So I'm kind of curious about then, after, you know, or you come to 30 something, mm-hmm. which, as you said, you know, is that kind of next step after family, you know, trying to bring something more real.
Yeah.
About relationships. And in the book, obviously, it's a very interesting dynamic. Marshall.
But let me back up, because there's something to be said about that, which is that the very first job I had was observing when Woody Allen was directing.
Yeah.
And there he was working with Diane Keaton, with whom he'd had this relationship, but they were no longer lovers, they were friends. And he showed me a very long draft of something that he had written called Anhedonia, which means the inability to experience pleasure. And it was the original draft of Annie Hall. And here was a movie about a relationship between two people, and there were the two people, mm-hmm. and yet they were, I mean, it was quite mind-bending to be 21 and to see this. I only evoke that because, you know, the idea of turning dross into gold wasn't the first time it had ever been done, but it was the first time I'd ever seen it. Mm-hmm. So that was in my mind already. And so I would just say that exists there, and then it's combined with things we're talking about family and about, mm-hmm. and about Last Night. All these things tend to aggregate into something. But as you said, it was taking a leap of certain leap of faith and a certain temerity to presume that our own lives were worth talking about.
Yeah.
And not only that, but talking about and being written about by the people who are living them at the time that they're living them, so that my wife at the time, a writer, would be dealing with Marshall, or we would deputize each other to try to sort of involve ourselves with each other's wives, because it was less complex to try to, you know, criticize them and get them to do what we wanted.
And Marshall's wife was also writing.
Marshall's wife was also writing. So it was a little bit of Bloomsbury.
And if anybody doesn't remember 30-something, it involved two couples were the primary focus, and husband and wife having issues and all kinds of things, and of course being written by two husbands and wives.
Right.
And it was quite a complex situation.
It was, you know, the serpent was swallowing its tail, you know, and the mirrors were mirroring each other. And by the way, it extended then to the cast, because you run out of your own materials, you start stealing from them. Mm-hmm. And now they're playing themselves. But there, it got even crazier, because Ken Olin and his wife are in the show not as husband and wife. So they're watching each other sleep with other people on stage, which must have made for some interesting conversations at home. But yeah.
Well, let's talk a little bit more about the films, too. And okay. There's so many, it's hard to pick. So I've picked a couple we talked about. And I want to start with Glory.
Okay.
And, you know, this amazing film, this, you know, landmark, you know, Civil War piece. And you know, in this case, you've got original source material.
Mm-hmm.
You have a credited screenwriter, but mm-hmm. clearly from the book, you've spent a fair amount of time writing it.
Mm-hmm.
And then also, you know, as we've talked about, there was the actor's input, both good and bad. So that there was a lot of the writing of the story that happened on, you know, in process. And, you know, one scene that stands out to me is the shout, but, you know, can you talk about the writing process of Glory?
Well, I mean, it was a breakthrough for me in a lot of ways. I had always been a history kid. I had gone to school in Boston, where I would walk past that St. Gaudens Memorial all the time. I visited the Civil War battlefields as a junior high school kid. I was interested already. Mm-hmm. But what I really discovered is that the script that I had and the script the studio wanted to make very quickly was revealed to me to be a kind of white savior narrative. It was about Matthew Broderick's character and how he was able to so influence these men. And the minute that I met, I cast those guys, because I was obliged to cast Matthew Broderick, he came with the package. But the minute that I met and started to work with Denzel and Morgan and Andre and Jimmy, it was very clear to me that that was the beating heart of the movie. And so I began, in some ways overtly and in some ways covertly, beginning to tilt the story toward them. And a movie can be an organic thing. It can change. It mm-hmm. can, in fact, not necessarily go where you think it's going. And for me, the lesson of it that applied to other movies was actually to not try to be so overdeterminative as to what's supposed to happen, but rather to be open to the present tense and to see as the camera sees, and to try to actually respond to what I was feeling. And what I was feeling was humbled and intimidated and utterly mesmerized by what was happening with those guys as we would rehearse together.
Mm-hmm.
And I just give that preamble because you want to talk about the shout. Well, that's one of those things in movies. That scene was written, it was in the original draft that the men do this, but it was written as if they did it somewhere in the middle as a bonding exercise. And what I saw very quickly was that it would work as the penultimate moment before they go to battle, which endowed it with a huge amount of intensity and content. But we were supposed to shoot it in a week, and then the schedule changed. And we were not prepared. That we didn't have a click track. We didn't have a pitch pipe. I mean, it was nothing. But the guys who were there in that circle were they were the dress extras. They were ex-military, they were lawyers, they were doctors, guys who had come from all over the country because they wanted to be part of this. They wanted to represent. They knew this story. And they were also, you know, as all guys are, they were a little bro and a little funny. And we shot a lot in the rain. And they began to sing. This is weeks before. They would sing this song like, I'm trying to do it with be a little not so profane, but there are a lot of words that rhyme with Zwick.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, oh, he makes us walk out in the rain. He is just a little, you know, and it just was fine. I'd heard them do it and it was a laugh and they just, you know, the way the soldiers do when they're marching.
Yeah.
To keep up their spirits. And there we are and it's the night and we're going to shoot it. And I don't know what to do, but I'd done enough theater and had done enough, you know, improv. That we started to sort of, I said, well, use the song. And what if the song is not more of a song? I mean, I was basically writing a Negro spiritual,
mm-hmm.
right? A white kid from Winnetka, writing a Negro spiritual. But this is the point about those guys. Their attitude was so beautiful because they didn't need any help. It was all available to them. They were listening to their own grandfathers and grandmothers and When I took a wrong foot, they just, you know, looked at me and shook their head and just helped me through it.
Mm-hmm.
But the point is that we had rehearsed. Morgan had done the Gospel of Colonus at BAM, where he played a preacher. And Jimmy Kennedy was a devoutly religious boy who had taken me to a Baptist hall in Savannah, Georgia. And we watched people rolling on the floor,
mm-hmm.
You know, speaking in tongues. And Andre, who, you know, was as far from any of that as anybody could be, was so perfect mm-hmm. for what that moment was. And Denzel wasn't going to show me anything until the day. And that's just him. And I just was taking it on faith that he was going to find something. And of course, what he found is maybe the most beautiful at all, because during the whole movie, he had set himself apart from everyone because that's the character. And he turned that moment into his embrace of them and by them. And that just kills you because that's how brilliant he is. And I cannot take credit for that.
Yeah.
I can take credit for creating an environment in which some genius like that can then bring it and do his own thing.
So, yeah, I think it's absolutely fascinating how that process comes together and how you explain it. Just to jump to another film for a second, you, and again, there are many things in your career, but Blood Diamond with Leonardo DiCaprio, you know, is one of those where whereas Glory is very set in a very historical context.
Mm-hmm.
I think the interesting thing I was thinking about from the writing perspective of Blood Diamond is there's definitely a basis in a news story that kind mm-hmm. of draws you into this, but then there's a whole bunch of other things. So it becomes both the recent history and the fiction, not the fictionalization to tell the truth.
Yeah.
Kind of the facts get, you mentioned the idea of facts get in the way of telling the truth sometimes.
Yeah.
So can you talk about the story of Blood Diamond and how you developed it?
I mean, when I first got out of college, I did write some journalism. I'd written some in college and I had an understanding of how one might go about it. And over the years, what I realized is that a filmmaker has given extraordinary entree to people and to things which others might not get so easily.
Mm-hmm.
And whether that meant dealing with the Department of Defense and the Inspector General's office about friendly fire, or whether it was about terrorism and the FBI counterterrorism task force, I had been given access. And so I knew how to begin, mm-hmm. but this involved finding people who would be a kind of Virgil to me, take me into worlds where I'd never been.
Yeah.
That involved a woman who I met who had been married to one of the sons of the De Beers family, who took me into places and invited me to smugglers and things I never had imagined doing. It involved a man named Sori Samora, a Sierra Leonean journalist who had been in Freetown and had shot film on video, which he'd never been able to release while he was there. But in order to try to let the facts resonate, let the story come from the personal, because finally, I mean, I've written a lot of things and done a lot of things that are in a epic format, But always to me, it is those relationships that are the center of it. And I'm trying to let them be placed on the edifice of those events. And in this case, it's about three people, you know, and I thought of like, you know, John Huston movies, and there's the guy who wants the diamond, there's the woman who wants the story, and there's the man who wants his son. And they all are sort of on this quest together, and you sort of put those elements into a pot and you stir it around and let them spin. But the story that she wants is about Sierra Leone, so it becomes rhetorical. He's a man who's born in Africa, a white man in Africa, with all of the conflicts that that suggests. So it becomes a story resonating from his character about those issues. And he's a man who will do anything for the sake of his son. And yet, through that son, you see the most terrible issue of all, which is child soldiers.
Right.
So I guess it was a kind of, I don't know, you know, a representation of things, and yet to bury those obvious lines in the reality of characters and flirty dialogue and fathers and sons and racist behavior and all that stew, which lets you not see. But I did do one thing when I wrote. I had a little, sometimes like get a little post-it, and I took a post-it and I put it on my computer, and I said, it said, "The child is the diamond." And that was the key to that movie. Now, what nobody ever realizes, the name we gave him was Dia, which is so obvious, but that's what it was. Yeah.
And the, and I mean, from a writing perspective, you know, in that instance, you started with something that was kind of given to you that felt a little bit like a buddy, you know, like adventure film.
Yeah.
And you turned it into something very different. And you know, one of the decision points you kind of hit on is, you know, DiCaprio's character was not meant to be African.
Yeah, in the original, there was an original draft that a studio had had, and the character of that Leo plays is an American, an American mercenary. God knows what the fuck he's doing in, you know, in Sierra Leone, but nonetheless, and without having given him his own conflicted story, the character would have been a kind of two-dimensional movie character. Instead, he's a cursed, you know, very conflicted man who ends up having just a little moment of recognition as he dies.
It's really, I mean, it's amazing, and I think it's an amazing story about that process of how you get from the original story to the one you create.
Yeah, and it takes too long.
Now, just think I have enough time to ask about this, but
sure.
You know, when you get to Defiance, which is a more recent film, Daniel Craig.
Is that a storm?
Yes, it is pouring out right now, which I did not expect. Cool. If you are all hearing that, it was not trucks, that's thunder.
Okay.
You know, with Daniel Craig in this story, again, you're taking something that has some real history to it, but you're also looking at your own personal history and your family's history. Can you talk about how that process of writing, you know, impacted you and why it was important?
Well, I mean, it's not my family's history, although my family, you know, lost people in the Holocaust.
Yeah.
And so there was some attempt to try to put myself, as one does as a personal filmmaker, to feel those things that one might have felt.
Yeah.
And the way that the script finally came together was I was skiing one day, cross-country skiing, and my binding broke. And I find myself in the middle of the woods, and I wasn't going to die, but suddenly my fingers are frozen, and I couldn't get the binding working. And I was looking around, and I didn't recognize where I was, and I was getting scared. And I thought, wait a second, this has happened to me in 5 minutes, and what must it have been like for these people to do this for 3 years?
Yeah.
What did it take? Who were those people, and who could I have been in that situation? And that way you can personally project yourself into, you know, a setting. But what I've been thinking about with Defiance, which is really interesting the way these things happen, is that movie, I think we made that 15 years ago. And it's a story about these two brothers, and this is true, the dialectic between one of them who only wants revenge, mm-hmm. and the other of whom wants to try to save the community. And I thought about what's just happened in Gaza and in Israel with Hamas, with the Israelis, that here is this dialectic within that same country of people having to confront that same issue. And it's not resolved yet, but that is ironically there in a movie that now can even be applied at least peripherally to a contemporary moment.
Yeah. Because as you mentioned in the book, when you approached this topic, it was partly because so often the depiction mm-hmm. of Jewish people in Europe was one of, you know, being a victim.
Yeah,
and you wanted to address that.
Yeah, well, the victimization myths are the myths that are informing both Israel and Gaza. You've got two countries with victimization myths, and that's a very volatile situation.
Yeah. So I think it's very interesting, and as you said, it definitely has resonance today. I want to talk about the book itself, and I want to say, you know, for those who don't have a copy yet, it's a very enjoyable read. There are juicy stories, which we are not going to tell you because you need to buy the book. So we're not going to tell you how in Shakespeare in Love, Julia Roberts was first cast and everything went wrong. You have to find the book and find out about that. And then also great stories about Tom Cruise and Denzel Washington and just, you know, the ups and downs and the process of making a movie and the complexity. The fun thing too in the book, you know, there are these interludes where you just throw in lists. Mm-hmm. And you know, 10 things they tried to teach me in film school, 12 ruminations of a writer director, which I think was my favorite, and the cost of doing business in 10 parts. And so these lists are full of little nuggets of stories of Hollywood and other things, and they're quite fun. But that gets me to the structure of the book, which I found very interesting. While somewhat chronological, you organize the book really by projects mm-hmm. as they were sort of in their prime. Mm-hmm. But as you read the book, you recognize that these projects, of course, often go back. Mm-hmm. So you're far in advance and you're talking about Defiance, but in truth, you know, you got that script way back here.
Mm-hmm.
And back there, you were doing another movie and working on something else. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I'm kind of curious about the decision process of writing the book by project. And I'm kind of curious about, you know, are there... Yeah, well, first, let's just start with why did you organize it in that way?
Because I didn't know not to. I mean, I you have to understand, I mean, probably from a very early moment, even in college, would I have loved to have written a book?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. But for 40 years, I literally did not think I had a subject. And it finally took a certain, you know, kick in the ass to look at myself in the mirror and say, oh, wait, I am the subject.
Mm-hmm.
And the point being that for the first months of writing, I didn't know that I was writing a book. In fact, you know how in your computer you have files and you label those files, you name them, and I labeled my file B-K. In other words, so as to not to offend the literary gods by saying that I was writing a book, and not even put the pressure on myself that I was writing a book. And I would write, I would write by films because each film marks you. Mm-hmm. Like the kids from Africa you would see on the streets of Paris, you know, with the tribal scars on their faces, yet they were now wearing suits. They each film, you know, you can chronologize your life by the years your kids are born, mm-hmm. you know, the year somebody dies, you know, and there are all sorts of ways to do it. But a film would inevitably take at a minimum it was 3 or 4 years,
yeah,
and in many cases it was 7.
Right.
So. You know, I often thought about it in terms of dog years, that you know, a year of filmmaking is really 7 years. I mean, that it really, these things somehow defined so many different things in my life. And it defined my growth as an artist. It defined what's happening in the culture. And so somehow it just, and I started doing it that way, so I didn't stop. I didn't have a plan. And the other thing I have to say is that when you write, we started this conversation saying a screenplay, mm-hmm. 120 pages, scenes that are 2 pages or 2-3 pages, it's got a, you know, exposition and a middle, it's got a, you know, climax, and it's got denouement and, you know, catharsis mm-hmm. and whatever. That's not a book.
Right.
Right. So where was I at any point? And how long is a scene? And how long is a chapter? And which way is up? Mm-hmm. And that was thrilling. And really, you know, nobody was telling me what it's supposed to be. And it wasn't about showing it to the audience and seeing what they felt. Mm-hmm. And that was unbelievably liberating and unbelievably terrifying, because it was just me.
Yeah. And, you know, so in the process of this organized look at your career, we also get some very deep understanding of your personal life. Mm. But it's not like we start out with, you know, your whole growing up. We start in film.
He was born in a trunk
yeah.
at the snow. No.
None of that. But I do feel like, you know, there are some very interesting observations about your relationship with your father, your, you know, family issues, your wonderful wife, who, you know, should be sainted based on how you present in the book.
You know, she maintains that she's not well enough treated. And I say, like, what are you talking about?
She has the best line in the book.
She does.
About the producer.
Yeah,
and so
she does.
Just, you'll read it. You'll see. But the, you know, so, I mean, how did you feel about inserting personal into this?
Well, that's, you know, it's not where it starts. Mm-hmm. And I have a couple of very, very, very gifted writer friends who are real writers as opposed to screenwriters. I mean, I can name them. One is Adam Gopnik.
Oh yeah.
One is Kurt Anderson. And these are really very accomplished, experienced mm-hmm. writers. And when I had something beginning to represent a draft, I showed bits to each of them, and they were very encouraging. But at the same time, both of them said something that I had no choice but to take to heart. And they said, we're going to say something to you that you probably have said to other writers and to actors, which is, where are you? Mm-hmm. And that's what the next, you know, six drafts were. And it's very easy to write that, because you just open up a vein mm-hmm. and just, you know, dip right into it. And I was afraid to do it, and then it became liberating.
Yeah. So it, I mean, I think, you know, it's very clear as you work your way through the book, you know, how much your artistic life intersects with your personal life, and that, you know,
and I probably should have known that from the very beginning, but it took a while.
The, you know, we mentioned this idea of, you know, even though the book is kind of project based, so many things go back, you know, and we're overlapping. And I know it probably varies at different times in your life, you know, but how do you segment your work? Because
how did I segment?
When you were working as, you know, or I mean, you're still working, obviously. Yeah. How do you segment all the things you have going on at once? How many projects are you balancing at a given time?
Well, you have to, because, you know, it's an art dictated by commerce. Mm-hmm. So I can be sitting there writing, but eventually I'm going to have to ask somebody for $30 or $40 or $100 million to do that. And the only way that happens is if you find the right financier at the right moment with the right actor mm-hmm. with the right story. And it's like Las Vegas, and it has to, those three cherries have to come up for the slot machine to pay out.
Yeah.
And it's also got to be the same for you. You have to feel that it's right. So there are a lot of these stars have to align. Mm-hmm. And the only way to do that is to ride several horses at once and to see which one makes it to the gate first. And that's always been the way, and I'm not alone in that. That's just the way of that life, the way it becomes. I happened to be really lucky when I was in the beginning of my career, and I met a lot of directors, very experienced, wonderful old lions mm-hmm. who, you know, told me stories, and I tried to listen.
Yeah. One of those was Sidney Pollack.
Yeah.
You talk a lot about Sidney Pollack.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, as an example, you know, what are some of the things that you feel like you got out of that kind of mentorship role?
Well, I mean, obviously, you know, the personal is the most important, and he was a very complex, very talented, funny, neurotic, competitive, supportive, every version of it. It was not Mr. Chips. It was not like, you know, it was not there was some tough love involved. There was some identification. He was from the Midwest, you know, another Jewish kid find his way to Hollywood. I'm not the first of those, but you know, there were things that were familiar. But also, he did something, which is that he would cast movie stars as actors. He would not cast them only to be iconic. He would know that movie stars wanted to dig and find things in movies that was not just about showing, trading on their celebrity or skating. He would demand things of them. And I saw that, but it was also a commercial formula, because he wanted to make movies that were not just guys shooting at each other, and was not just, you know, a chase or a comedy. It was whether it was about, you know, about Africa, or whether it was about, you know, the, a man dressing up as a woman. They were not obvious movies.
Yeah.
So one way that he knew that he had to get them going was to have movie stars in them that would give some comfort to the financier, some elusive notion that you can protect your bottom line, which never turns out to be true if the movie's bad.
Yeah. I want to give the audience a
sure.
chance to ask a couple questions, but I want to ask my last question I'll ask you is, as I know you mentioned, you know, multiple drafts, took a while to get through probably and get it right as a book. So, but as a director and an editor, you probably left some stuff on the cutting room floor.
Sure.
Is there one that you left on the cutting room floor that you regret?
Oh God, there was one the other day I was thinking of. No, there's so many anecdotes, and I'm the butt of every joke in there. When I made my first movie, the studio decided to take the cut to Paramus, New Jersey, and your first screening of your first movie, and all scrutiny is on you. And we're in this theater, and the movie starts, and the first reel is up. Remember, we're in reels back then. This is not digital. Yeah. There's a reel, and it's going okay. They're laughing, right? And then he switches reels, and it's the sixth reel. The projectionist had screwed it up totally. And I was like, I mean, I'm dying. So what I do, I break out of the theater, and I find the stairs, and I run up the stairs into the projection booth, and I bang the door open. The guy's terrified, and I'm so, what the fuck are you doing? And I'm all crazy like this. And he's so, I go, this is the wrong reel. He goes, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. And he pulls off the reel, and he puts on the next reel, I mean, which is the second reel, the right reel. But in doing so, he has banged the projector, so when he turns it on again, now the movie is shooting down into the audience. And so, I mean, that was the beginning. I mean, that story goes on and on, but there was one. I forgot it. I was blocked it. Clearly, it was too painful. Yeah.
I appreciate you talking to me. I was going to ask the audience, if you would like to ask a question, there's a microphone at a stand in the back, and if you just go there, you can ask your question. I will say what I say every now and again. A question is normally no more than 1 to 2 sentences, and it ends in a question mark. Come on up.
Okay. Hi, Ed. I'm Patty McMillan. I was at your bar mitzvah many, many years ago.
Patty.
I had my first pair of high heels, which
Wait
my grandmother
second.
Bought without telling my mother she was doing so.
I have to ask a question.
Yes, darling.
Do you still play the claw-footed banjo?
The clawhammer banjo.
Clawhammer banjo.
I have moved on. I still own clawhammer banjos, and I play them occasionally.
Well, you've broken my heart. I'm glad that I came back.
But now I'm playing the banjo ukulele. Anyway, and Steve Baird's here too. We're your junior high school contingent. I really just want to make a comment. It's not really a question. So, okay, there's somebody behind me, which is I want everyone in this audience to know that Ed still has the twinkle that he had at 13 years old. I can't believe it. It's so good to see you. It's so good to hear about somebody's life, not at their funeral. Thanks for coming.
Hi. Weren't the soldiers of the 54th aware that if something went wrong in the battle and they were captured, it would be likely that they'd either be bayoneted or sold back into slavery, like happened at Fort Pillow and the crater later? And the actors, knowing this, did they project that kind of desperation
Yeah, there's a scene in the movie actually where they're told that they're going to be shot and put to death as spies, but I think what the actors felt was analogous to the things you're talking about, because they had given up their jobs, they had traveled across the country, they were living in tents, it was raining, they were getting shitty food, and they didn't care because they were there, because they knew why they were there. And I couldn't have made the movie without them. They worked for nothing. There were reenactors, these amazing living historians who do this all the time, if you can imagine. And without them, because we didn't have a lot of money to make the movie, believe it or not, we couldn't have made the movie.
Are streaming services hurting the movie business, getting people back to the theater, or how would you suggest people coming back in droves pre-COVID?
Let me ask you a question with a question. How many streaming movies have you saw and really loved?
Not many.
And why do you think that is?
It's not on the big screen. You can't see it larger than life. Distractions of the refrigerator, the phone, the lighting.
But also there was an economic thing that happened, which is these guys and all these services, there was a lot of cheap money and they got a shitload of money and they over milked the cow. And they created so much product that was of similar shape, and they were movies being done by retail companies. Apple is a retail company. Amazon is a retail company. And they were creating things to please and creating things that were sort of pre-imagined as a product. And it didn't have, and it doesn't have still, with certain exceptions, there's great work too, but it doesn't have the eccentricity and the uniqueness of what a movie was as it was created and as it was marketed. It's done just as part of an interface, and all seems equivalent.
Good evening. I was a big fan of the TV shows, 30-something and My So-Called Life. And since you have been a producer as well, I wanted to ask you a little bit about that role. When we see movies these days, there, even TV shows, there can be 5, 10, 20 different people who are on the credits as producers. Has that changed since your early days in the, in the business?
Oh no, when I did it, when we talked about Family, when we did Family, there was a woman who was the executive story editor, there was her husband as a producer, and there was me, and I was the story editor. That was it. Three of us made 22 episodes. Now, titles have become a way of actually not paying people money, so that the bloating of titles is just this thing that happens, so that the manager gets a title and the line producer gets a title and obviously the story editor. I mean, so you can have that many titles. It's not true, fortunately, in movies. Television, it has had that happen. In movies, and in part because of Harvey Weinstein, it would happen with me and Shakespeare in Love, that my partner was involved with the Producers Guild, where it was finally adjudicated, where you had to go before a board, it had to be, you know, approved that you would get a title, because the title, a role of producer, had been so diminished. But it's not like that in television. Television, it's just a producer fest.
Huge fan of About Last Night. It was a movie, I was born in 80. I was definitely too young to watch it. It was probably one of the first sex scenes I saw was Rob Lowe and Demi Moore, so thank you for that. But, I always paid attention to directors, so when I really started to look, I'm like, wow, Edward Zwick, like Glory and these other films have done it About Last Night. Mm-hmm. And you see something, and you see it in other filmmakers all the time. And I always think, like, when you're making a film like that, About Last Night, like, are you envisioning these bigger projects, or are you just focused on what's in front of you and not thinking about that? Or were you even imagining the possibility of a Glory, like, whatever, 3 years later?
I couldn't have made Glory if I hadn't made About Last Night or hadn't done the 40 hours of television between them, because that was like learning piano exercises and doing scene after scene and shooting film after, you know, scene after scene, that I knew so much more. I had more mastery of the medium because of them. It was still a stupid thing to try, but that's how it happened.
Thanks again for speaking with us tonight. My question was about the film The Last Samurai, which I don't think has been mentioned here tonight, but you know, I love that film. I moved to Japan just a few months after it came out. It really informed my, you know, kind of my knowledge of Japanese history, got me more inspired. But I was wondering for you personally, when was that seed first planted for you? I mean, when did you first become interested in Japanese history and the, you know, the Meiji Restoration? And what inspired you to create that film?
There was a book that I read in college called The Nobility of Failure. And it was a story, it had a lot of different stories in it, but it was about Saigo Takamori, who was the man who rebelled against the Meiji. And so that's really where it began. Although, truth be known, it probably began right around the same time when I first saw The Seven Samurai, because there is no better movie that's ever been made. And if there were one movie that had to exist, that you would be on a desert island and learn everything there is to learn, it would be that movie. Because it's just a masterclass in exposition and in action and in character and in geography and in pace and in humor. I mean, it's a perfect movie. So that was maybe already in my mind that someday I would be able to do something about samurai.
Thank you.
Yeah.
And just so you know, it is in the book in great detail. So with that, we have just hit an hour, and I want everyone to give a great thanks to our wonderful guest, Ed Zwick.